Okay, so let's slightly change the gear. We go to the solid state physics portion, and with whatever I had discussed with you. So today's lecture I will give on free electron theory, and tomorrow's lecture I will give more on the basic lattice, the Bravais lattice and the reciprocal lattice, and Bragg's law and the Lois law. That's what I am planning to do for tomorrow. See, of course, you know, this particular part we also do normally in our first year course. We include this particular part, but this normally we do after when we do particle in a three-dimensional box and we derive the energy states for a particle in three-dimensional box. Then we talk a little bit about the statistics. Then we differentiate what is the difference between Bose-Einstein statistics, Fermi-Dirac statistics, and also the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. And then eventually we come to the solid state physics. So last three or four lectures are basically based on free electron theory. So, I mean, from whatever we have been doing first year, probably there is a little bit of a gap between that and that, but I have tried to make it up by adding additional transparencies, but you know, maybe there are certain deficiencies, so let's hope you will accept it. So generally when we talk of solids, the first thing that we normally talk is about metals, because metals out of all the solids had been the most interesting part historically, because the ages have been named after metals. And also, as far as solid state physicists are concerned, they are known to have very high electrical and thermal conductivities. These are the two things which signifies metal from many other different type of solids. They have very high electrical conductivity and high thermal conductivity. And that's the reason most of the electrical wire connections are all metallic. Now, 1897 was the time when J.J. Thomson discovered electron. And 1900 was the year when Brood gave his theory for the metals. And it's very interesting that just after 3 years, he could tell something which are, of course, not 100% correct from today's word, but nevertheless, he could approach the problem reasonably correctly. Let me also add at this particular point that some of the things which I am going to talk about it, you know, are from today's perspective. Of course, at that time of Brood, probably they were not, I mean, for example, the electronic structure, etc., they were not known at that particular time. They were much later known. Bohr's theory came much later. So there was no clarity, but that's why it makes it much more interesting that, you know, Root could think, you know, so much into this particular material, these metals. So he developed what is now known as a free electron theory. So what he assumed, I mean, at that time, as I was telling, that most fashionable theory was kinetic theory of gases. So he also talked about kinetic theory of gases. And he assumed that in these metals, there are large number of free electrons. A free electron means they are under the influence of no force, which essentially means that he neglected the interaction between electron and electron, because if there are large number of electrons, electrons are electrostatically negatively charged. Therefore, they are always going to be interacting with amongst each other. Also, because overall metal is neutral, so if electrons are free, so whatever has been left behind, which we can call as core, okay, must be positively charged particles. And therefore, these electrons, when they are moving, they must also be getting influenced, or a force must be exerted on them because of the positive charges. But all those things were neglected by Brood. Just assume that these electrons are totally free. And applied essentially all the concepts of kinetic theory of gases that we apply on gas molecules, even though the density here turns out to be much larger than the density of gas at NTP. But even then, many orders of magnitude, I think 2 or 3 orders of magnitude, still he applied the same thing. So now what was thought as a positively charged core can be thought of as a valence electron. And I mean, it's not a valence electron, it's core electrons. And it's the valence electrons which in today's world or today's time, we can think that's the final outermost electrons are the which are the loosely bound, and they become rather free. And that's what I said. He neglected electron-electron interaction. He neglected electron-core interaction. There is only one difference which he made from the normal kinetic theory of gases, which normally people do. In kinetic theory of gases, they are only gas molecules. So the only collision which takes place between the molecules themselves. Here he assumed that the collisions that these electrons make while they are traveling are not amongst themselves. He did not include that particular aspect. But he assumed that these collisions are taking place from the cores, because he realized that probably electrons are much lighter particle, so heavier particle must be the one which are being left behind, which are not free. And therefore, when these electrons are moving, the chances that they will get scattered by these heavier particles are much more. Probably that was the thinking. So he assumed that the scattering of these electrons are taking place from the positive cores. That's one difference from the standard kinetic theory of gases, where as I said, we assume that molecules collide amongst themselves. Here he assumed that electrons are colliding with the positive cores which has been left behind. So that's what I have written. The only way electrons seize core is by scattering. Otherwise, there is no force. It's obviously an approximation, you know, because you know that electrostatic charges have to be present and that interatomic distances are fairly small. There has to be forces, but it was all neglected. Now, like kinetic theory of gases, he introduced the concept of relaxation time. He introduced that the probability that electron will get scattered in time dt is proportional to dt upon tau. Tau was supposed to be a constant, which is generally called relaxation time, like kinetic theory of gases. And this relaxation time was assumed to be independent of position and the velocity of the electrons. Irrespective of whatever is the velocity of the electron, irrespective of what is the position of the electron, the relaxation time was assumed to be same. So it was not supposed to depend on that. Now, using this particular idea, he could derive Ohm's law. Ohm's law is one of the very, very fundamental laws of electricity, almost like Newton's law of motion. Let us focus our attention on one electron, which has just come out of a collision. And let's assume that its velocity is V naught. So consider an electron whose velocity immediately after collision, let's call that time as time t is equal to 0, is V naught. And let's assume that we have applied electrical field to the system. When we apply electrical field to the system, this particular electron, remember it's all classical mechanics, there was no quantum mechanics at that time. Okay, so this particular electron will experience a force as per Newton's law. And therefore, this electron's velocity would change under the influence of electric field until the time it suffers the next collision. That's basically the idea. So electron will collide, then after collision, its velocity becomes random, then again accelerates because of the electric field, then again collides, then again it becomes random. A situation something like this. So let us suppose at a time t, it has not suffered a collision. At time t is equal to 0, it suffered a collision. At a time t, when it has not suffered a collision, let us try to calculate what will be its velocity. If the electric field is E, the force on the electron will be E times E, of course with a negative sign. Okay, and therefore acceleration would be force divided by mass. So E upon m will be the acceleration of this particular particle. And during time t, it's getting accelerated. Its initial velocity was V naught. So it's basically applying the kinematics equation. It will be the velocity at time t will be given by V naught minus EE. E is the force divided by m, which is makes it acceleration, multiplied by the time. So the velocity at time t of this electron will be given by this thing, provided of course the electron does not suffer collision. Now what I am interested is in calculating the average of this particular velocity, not only on this particular electron, but over all the electrons, because that's what is going to give rise to the current. So that's what he called as a drift velocity, averaged over all the particles. So when you average this particular expression, because in principle, the velocity of the particle after the collision is going to become random. Therefore, average of V naught I can make is 0, because it is equal probability that the particle will get scattered in all the directions. So average of V naught I take it to be 0. Now, this we take the average. This is constant, this is constant, this is constant. We take the average of T, so that will be the relaxation time. So the drift velocity from that very simple expression, he gets as minus EE tau upon m. This is what we call as the drift velocity, because the electron is simply drifting. It's almost the typical way as the air drifts, though the actual, it may be the electron may still be moving, but their average velocity may be 0. It's almost like air drift. So there are molecules which are still moving at a great velocity in this particular hall, air molecules, but we do not see. When there is a net drift of this particular thing, then we feel that there is a breeze going on. Exactly the same thing. Now let us assume that there are total number of n electrons per unit volume into the system. Then we can define the current density, standard expression of current density as minus Ne times drift velocity. You put the expression of drift velocity which we have just now calculated, so it becomes Ne square tau by m. So this Ne square tau by m is called conductivity of the material, and you get the expression J is equal to sigma E, where sigma is Ne square tau by m. It's called the conductivity of the material, and resistivity of the material is 1 upon sigma. Now, what I insist that this expression is nothing but the Ohm's law. Normally, Ohm's law is given in the form of V is equal to IR. But, you know, from a point of view of solid state physics, okay, generally, current is not very important. Current density is more important. Okay, the voltage is not important. The field is more important. resistance is not more important, but resistance depends on the shape of the sample. Okay, what's more important, the resistivity or conductivity?
This is called the resistivity of the material. As I said that, you know, V is equal to IR, in principle, is exactly the same thing. If you convert this electrical field into the potential, you know, take a particular shape of the material, okay, let's suppose let it could be wire, it could be whatever it is, okay, then same thing can be written in the form of V is equal to IR. So this is nothing but Ohm's law. Now, general, these are the typical values of the resistivities which normally we observe. Of course, resistivity depends on a lot of factors. It depends on temperature, depends on how pure you are able to make the material, it depends on purity. So, it depends on the purity of the material, but a typical value, these are just the typical values I would say, which I have taken from a textbook. The resistivity of copper at 77K, which is the boiling point of liquid nitrogen, is 0.3 micro ohm centimeter. Just take care of the units, because these units are neither SI units nor Gaussian units. Okay, ohm is supposed to be a SI unit, but centimeter is actually a Gaussian unit. Somehow, in solid state physics, people are used to using the units of ohm centimeter, probably due to semiconductor guys, because you know they always find you, if they express an ohm centimeter, 1 ohm centimeter, 2 ohm centimeter, that's the type of order of the resistivities. Whatever it is, generally resistivities are expressed in terms of ohm centimeter, which is not a very good thing. So this is what I have used. And if you go to 273K, which is room temperature, the resistivity becomes higher, which is 1.56 micro ohm centimeter. Now you use these particular values in this particular expression. Okay. Now what you can do, you can approximately estimate what will be the value of N. Okay. Of course, these days we can estimate easily, assuming that, for example, let's take alkali metals. Okay. The outermost electron, which is the last S shell electron, becomes free. So each atom gives you one particular electron. Okay. So you know how many number of atoms are there per unit volume. If you know the density of the material, if you know the atomic weight of the material, you can always calculate total number of atoms per unit volume. And assume that each of these atoms is contributing one free electron. So you can estimate what will be your value of N. You can estimate what is your value of N. Now, I have already got the experimental value of resistivity. So I can know what is the experimental value of conductivity. Just take inverse of that particular thing. Okay. E, we know fundamental constant. M, we know what is the mass of the electron. Okay. You can estimate what will be the value of tau, which is the relaxation time. Now, if you do that particular thing, the tau turns out to be of the order of 10 to the power minus 9 seconds. You know, it's fairly small. It means the electron is able to accelerate only about 10 to the power minus 9 seconds. No, not minus. Okay, please. Minus. I'm probably confusing with numbers. Number is much smaller than that thing. Yeah. J is equal to sigma I.
J is equal to sigma I.
I don't think.
This is also known as microscopic forms of Ohm's law.
At least I have never heard about this particular uses of the term, or nor I have myself ever used it. We always call it Ohm's law, because as far as I am concerned, there is no difference between this and Ohm's law. Okay, I can give you an example. You take particular wire, just convert electric field into voltage. Okay, just E by D. Okay, and just take current density. Take current density is current divided by area of cross section. It will just come out to V is equal to IR. At least I do not form. Because I do not know, maybe there's some person who likes to call it, but I do not know.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
It is called as microscopic form because the equation carries a term sigma, which can be represented in terms of carrier concentration, mobility of charge carriers.
Yeah.
So the conventional V is equal to IR law, it doesn't talk about the charge carriers involved in conduction. Now, when you write the same law for semiconductors, you talk about both electron holes contributing for the current, and that's the reason it is generally preferred as a microscopic.
I say this is a matter of again semantics. Personally I don't see any reason why it should be called different when I can derive one from the other, where they are exactly the same identical things, you know, you are putting in a different form. Okay, I personally don't. I mean, maybe there are some people who prefer it to call it because of whatever reason, because of what reason you have called. But at least, as I say, I have not come across any book who calls it microscopic form of Ohm's law. I mean, take any standard solid state physics book, you know, take Kittel, Ashcroft, Merman, etc. Everyone will call it Ohm's law. This is Ohm's law. So, but maybe there are some authors who have used it. I will not deny them. Okay, now we define something what is called a mean free path. Approximately the distance that a particular electron travels before it suffers a collision. Now, this particular thing is defined not as drift velocity multiplied by time, but the RMS velocity multiplied by time, because as I said, the electron's actual speed is much different. Okay, the average velocity is different. See, like as I said, in this particular hall, there are molecules, air molecules, which are traveling with reasonably large velocities, but I don't feel them because the average velocity of all these molecules becomes zero. But if you look at the particular molecule, if I were to ask the question, how much a molecule actually travels before it suffers a collision, then I have to take its actual speed into consideration, not the average speed. And that actual speed is supposed to be given by the RMS speed. Okay, so therefore, we should write half mv square is equal to 3 by 2 kt using again classical our kinetic theory of gases. And from that, you can calculate what will be the value of RMS. If you do that, I'm sorry, that's what I was telling, that I thought I was getting confused. The relaxation time turns out to be of the order of minus 14 seconds and not minus 9 seconds. And RMS speed turns out to be of the order of 10 to the power 5 meters per second. If you just do that calculation, order of magnitude. And therefore, the mean free path turns out to be of the order of 10 to the power minus 9 meters, which is typically 10 angstrom. A nanometer, which is typically of the order of 10 angstrom. This particular value is a very, very reasonable value because generally it's known that interatomic distances are of the order of few angstrom. Okay? Most of the lattice constants are 4, 5 angstrom. So, distance between the atoms are of that particular order. And that's what Drude had assumed, that when it suffers a collision, when electron suffers a collision because of this positive course. So, having a mean free path of the order of interatomic distances is a very, very reasonable assumption. It appears to be, whole thing appears to be fairly consistent. Here's the assumption that these electrons suffer a collision from positive charges being approximately distance of nanometer, and mean free path also turning out to be of the order of nanometer. So everything looks to be consistent. However, there are certain problems. This is what I'm trying to tell about the problems. Of course, first few problems that I'm going to tell are probably were not known at that particular time. They are much better known now because the data and understanding of the subject become more clear. But one thing which, for example, I have already told you, that resistance or resistivity, for example, depends quite drastically on temperature. The value which I had given you, it changes only almost by an order of magnitude as we go from 77K to room temperature for copper. Now, here we are not very clear, because the only factor on which the resistivity depends is relaxation time. Why relaxation time between 77K and room temperature will become so large that resistivity becomes one order of magnitude larger? After all, those atoms, I mean those cores are still there at 77K. They are also present at room temperature. Okay, probably they are vibrating a little bit more. Okay, I can understand probably their, you know, scattering will go up slightly, but I cannot understand that that will change almost by an order of magnitude. Not only that, it also depends on the crystalline quality and purity. If you make impure material, if you take a pure metal, as purer is the material, you will find conductivity to be much better. Of course, as I said, these data were not available at that particular time. If you make a material pure, okay, conductivity will be much larger. If you put certain impurities, you suddenly find that the conductivity goes down, the resistivity increases. Okay? It also depends on the crystalline quality. If you make a highly, very good quality single crystal of the material, okay, then you'll find that resistivity is very low, conductivity is very large. If you create certain defects, dislocations, etc., you make material polycrystalline or you make material amorphous, okay, you'll find the resistivity goes up. Now, again, it's not very clear because these cores are always there, whether you're talking of crystalline material, whether you're talking of polycrystalline material, or whether you're talking of amorphous material, okay. Why the resistivity depends so much on the crystalline quality? Why it depends on purity? If instead of copper, I have added some silver there, okay, why silver atom? Of course, the silver core is similar to copper core. Why the resistivity will change by so much of order of magnitude? This was not clear. Okay, I can just tell that these days, of course, it's possible to get almost mean free path of the order of a centimeter. It's possible to do it. You know, you cannot understand how mean free path of that larger magnitude can be obtained. But as I said, many of these things are known now. At that particular time, during the time of Drude, the biggest objection came from the last statement which I am making, overall small contribution to the specific heat of solid. This was the major objection against the Drude theory, which people could not understand or Drude could not explain. Let me try to explain this particular part a little bit in more detail. I have not done kinetic theory of gases, for that matter, the classical part in detail, but I am pretty sure that all of you know about Dulong and Petit law, which is a very, very famous law, which essentially tells that the molar specific heat at constant volume for all the solids is 3R. Normally, when it's taught in high school, it's taught in the form of product of molecular weight and the specific heat. But there, normally in high school, we talk of a specific heat per gram. But in solid state physics, we always talk of molar specific heat, one mole of the material. And then we talk of molar specific heat at constant volume. And that depends on what we call as derivative of internal energy with respect to temperature, because at constant volume, PdV term is zero. So it's just du by dt. That's the specificity at constant volume. And the total energy of the system can always be calculated by equipartition law, which actually I have flashed at transparency rather hurriedly last time, which tells you that because a particular atom inside a solid, if you are talking about a conventional solid, it has 3 degrees of freedom per atom, because it can vibrate in 3 different directions independently, and because all these are vibration, so there is half kT of kinetic energy, half kT of potential energy, so there is a total of kT energy per degree of freedom. So there is a 3 times kT, and because they are Na in a mole, they are Na, that is Avogadro number of atoms. So 3 Na into kT will be the total energy. You differentiate with respect to temperature, you get 3 Na times k, which is 3 R. Now problem is that in the case of metals, now we have just now said that there is another possibility, there is another channel for heat to be absorbed, because these particular atoms are also now leaving, let's assume, 1 electron per atom. So each atom is contributing 1 electron, which becomes free. So when I am heating the material, not only the heat is being consumed for these particular atoms to vibrate, but will also be used to supply kinetic energy to the free electrons. Okay, in fact, when I have used half mv RMS square is equal to 3/2 kT, that's what I was assuming, that when I have heated the system, then these particular electrons have also gained energy because of the heat. So if I am looking at the total internal energy of the system, not only I should use what we call as a lattice contribution or contribution due to vibration of the atom, but I must also use, assuming that each atom is contributing 1 free electron, the kinetic energy gained by these electrons when I heated them to a temperature T. Now again, an electron will have 3 degrees of freedom because it can move in 3 different directions, but it cannot vibrate because it's free. Okay, so there is only half kT of kinetic energy contribution. Therefore, for each electron, I must have a half kT additional amount of energy. So therefore, if everything whatever I have said is true, then what I should see that for the case of metals, I must get a specific heat of 4.5 R, not 3 R. So in principle, if everything is consistent because of the kinetic theory of gases, then what I should observe that if I am having an insulating solid, then the specific heat of that particular solid should be 3 R, and specific heat for a metal should be 4.5 R. But that was never observed. It was observed, of course, let's be very, very clear, that this value of 3 R is only the high temperature limit of the specific heat, because specific heat tends to zero as we lower the temperature. Okay, once we have much more modern theories, we know that 3 R is only the high temperature limit of specific heat for the solids. But nevertheless, whether you are talking of metals or whether you are talking of insulators, you still get the value 3 R. You do not get 4.5 R, as if these electrons are not gaining energy from the heat. Okay, if the free electrons are not gaining energy from the heat, then whatever I have said earlier about half mv square is equal to 3/2 kT is meaningless. This was one of the biggest objection against the Drude model. After that, when the quantum mechanics came and the concept of quantum statistics came, there was a huge period of time. The second model, which is also a free electron model, which got developed, which is called Sommerfeld model, again free electron, all the assumptions of Sommerfeld were exactly identical as the original Drude's model. No changes, okay. Only difference is that he applied quantum mechanics to the problem and quantum statistics to the problem. He realized that when we are talking of these electrons, electrons cannot be treated as a classical particle. Even though they may be free, I must treat these electrons as if they are bound inside a box. And therefore, whatever we have found out the energy states of a particle in a three-dimensional box, those are the energy states I must use. Because I am still assuming that electron-electron interaction is zero, I am still assuming that electron-core interaction is zero. So I can treat whatever was the energy states of a particle in a three-dimensional box, same energy states can be used for these particular electrons. Of course, the number of electrons will be very large. If you are taking 1 mole of the substance, there will be typically 10 to the power 23 electrons, that's the order of Avogadro number, okay. But nevertheless, whatever they are, okay, they are going to occupy only those states which are the quantum energy states. The second thing that he mentioned, he proposed that electrons are the particles which are non-integral spins, so they must obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. It means one particular state cannot be occupied by more than 1 electron, or if you include spin, 2 electrons. All right? So the states that we have, remember, in the normal Schrodinger equation, we do not talk about spins. So whatever state that we have derived from quantum mechanics, in principle, can be occupied by two electrons, one by spin up and one by spin down. So if you take the ground state of, let's say, particle in a three-dimensional box, the ground state will be given, will be occupied by two electrons. Now that makes things quite different, because though we have talked about 23 electrons, okay, if you go to the ground state, because these are fermions, which obey fermionic statistics, even at 0 degree Kelvin, all the 10 to the power 23 electrons cannot go and occupy the ground state, because they are fermions. So only two electrons will be occupying the ground state. All right. Now, next electron that we are supplying to the system, okay, have necessary to go to the higher energy states. And remember, we have to accommodate something like 10 to the power 23 electrons. You will find that even we are at 0 degree Kelvin, you will find a large number of states, even at 0 degree Kelvin, will get filled. So that's what makes things different as far as Sommerfeld model is concerned. So let's just look into slightly more detail about the Sommerfeld model. Let me just read. Uses all the assumption of Brood model, but applied quantum mechanics and quantum statistics to the problem. Assume that the energy states of a free electron in a metal are similar to that of a particle in a three-dimensional box. Electrons obey Fermi-Dirac statistics. So these are the only differences which he made. Otherwise, everything is same as free electron. I mean, this is also called free electron theory. This Sommerfeld is also free electron theory. Now, there's only one small difference. Many times we use the same old boundary condition which we normally use for a particle in a three-dimensional box. But then we have some difficulty if you start talking about dynamics. So let me just mention a few minutes about this particular boundary condition. When we solve particle in one-dimensional box, the boundary condition that we apply is that wave function is 0 at x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L prime. Probably all of you are aware about it. That when we solve the quantum mechanics problem of a particle in a box, which I could not do, I hurriedly did it, because you expect that wave function will disappear at the two ends where potential energy becomes infinity. So you apply psi is equal to 0 at x is equal to 0 and psi is equal to 0 at x is equal to L. Similarly, when you solve the problem for a particle in a three-dimensional box in a quantum mechanics course, okay, we apply exactly the same boundary condition that wave function disappears at x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L, then y is equal to 0 and y is equal to L, z is equal to 0 and z is equal to L. Okay, that's the way we apply, and then we get certain energy states. However, when we want to apply the same idea to solid state physics, we land up into a small problem. So let me just illustrate this particular problem so that, you know, there is a certain amount of clarity. The problem is that the solutions are that those equations, for example, if you take particle, even, let's talk about particle in a one-dimensional box, because that's much more, we are much more familiar with that. Okay, the solutions that we get are stationary wave solutions. Now, what happens when we are trying to describe the motion of electrons inside a solid? We have to assign a particular direction. We cannot accept solutions which are a stationary wave, because in a stationary wave, there is no net transfer of energy. So if we are going to associate a wave function to the electron, okay, we never like to associate a wave function to the electron, which is in the form of a standing wave. See, like when we are talking of a scattering from a particular, you know, barrier, we wanted to put them in the form of e raised to power ikx, because we want to assign a direction. Therefore, we will also like to obtain, as a result of solution of Schrodinger equation, solutions which are not really standing wave. So Born and von Karman had proposed a different type of boundary condition. These are also called periodic boundary conditions. Okay. Strictly speaking, there is no clear logic of these particular boundary conditions, though people give a lot of logic. If you look at any book on solid state physics, for that matter, for any book, even on modern physics, they will give that solid may be treated as circle or whatever it is, and, you know, the ends may not be free. But in fact, I like one of the books which very, very boldly writes, strictly speaking, these are only arguments for argument's sake. Let's accept that this works. That's what we are going to do. So the boundary condition that we apply, that instead of saying that wave function at this end and this end is zero, we say wave function at the two ends are equal. That's all we do. Okay. So rather than making it zero, we say that whatever is the wave function here, same should be the wave function here. Now you can say, what is the reason the wave function should be here? It's just to somehow address that there is a boundary there. Okay. It could be something different, but I mean, as I said, one of the arguments which is given, if the, normally the solid is so large in comparison to interatomic distance, so these ends are immaterial. So if the ends are immaterial, so I take them to be the same. I mean, but as I said, these, if you go deeper into that, the arguments are not really excellent arguments. But these are the arguments which people have been using almost for almost 100 years. These are the boundary conditions. Again, one of the dark area where you cannot really 100% explain, but nevertheless, it works. So these are the boundary conditions that we use. The net advantage of this particular using boundary condition is that we do not get stationary waves. Even negative values of k become allowed, and therefore you can assign a direction to the motion of the electron. So if you use this particular boundary condition, this is what you get. In fact, the density of state turns out to be exactly identical. So even if you use that stationary wave boundary condition, density of state, there is never a problem. So if we apply these boundary conditions, which we, I mean, remember in the case of particle in a three-dimensional box, you apply this particular thing that at x, this is equal to 0, then put L and then put it equal to 0. All I am putting here that this plus this is equal to this plus this. I think the BZ term, I have probably missed it. There should have been a plus KZ term also. It doesn't matter. No. So basically what you're getting, you are getting KX is equal to 2N pi by L. In that case, you are getting KX is equal to N pi by L. Here you get 2N pi by L. But here the negative values of K also become allowed. So overall, the total number of states allowed remains same, except that in the normal particle in a box, you have only positive values of Ks are allowed, but they're half spaced. Here, both positive and negative values are allowed, but the spacing becomes double. Now, using that, you can always find out density of state. So you take all the allowed values of K and plot into it, because eventually we have to deal with a very large number of states, okay, because there are going to be almost 10 to the power 23 particles that we have to accommodate. So we start with quantum states, but then we realize because L is going to be very, very large here, okay, so therefore the spacing between them is going to be extremely fine, it's going to be extremely fine mesh. Okay, so for the purpose of density of a state, we calculate them in the form of a continuous distribution. So that's what we do. So we plot, of course this is highly exaggerated and it's only in two dimension, we have to do in three dimension. We take the values of kx, ky, kz and plot into a three dimensional graph paper. Okay, so all values are allowed. So you have one point allowed here, one point allowed here, one point allowed here, like that. You plot all of them. Once you plot all of them, then you take a particular value of k and draw a sphere in this particular thing. You take another value of k, which is slightly larger than k, which is k plus dk. You draw another sphere. Then find out how many number of these points are going to lie in this small shell that is going to be created by these two spheres because of the intersection of these two spheres, one of radius k, another of radius k plus dk. Now, whatever are the number of points which are falling in this particular shell, okay, that will be the number of points or number of states allowed between wave vector k and k plus dk. One thing which I would like to always insist on this particular thing and make, I mean, basically point it out, that boundary conditions are always applied in the real space. At x is equal to this, something happens. The wave function becomes zero or wave function becomes equal. So whenever we are applying quantization condition in solid state physics, we always limit the values of k's. Okay, so from that you will always get that these are the allowed values of wave vectors. Okay. On the other hand, statistics like Fermi-Dirac statistics, Bose-Einstein statistics depends on the energy. Okay. It always gives you what is the occupancy of a level of a particular energy. Okay. So I have to always convert from K space to E space, energy space. For that, we use what we call as a dispersion relation, a relationship between K and E, which is one of the most important part of any solid state physics problem. Relationship between K and E. Of course, this is a free electron case, so the E versus K relationship becomes very, very simple, because E is just equal to P square by 2m, h square k square by 2m. K represents the momentum. So E is just equal to h square k square by 2m. Now we find out what will be the volume of this particular shell. Volume of this particular shell, this surface area is 4 pi k square and thickness is dk. So the volume of this particular shell will be 4 pi k square dk. Now how many points are expected to be falling in this particular thing? We realize that this particular thing is essentially like a simple cubic lattice with a lattice constant of 2 pi by L, because the distance between these two atoms is, these two points is 2 pi by L. This is in the inverse of length units. This distance is also 2 pi by L. Okay. Now, so it's essentially like a simple cubic lattice where the lattice constant is 2 pi by L. Of course, this is in the inverse of length of space. Now, in simple cubic lattice, we know that on the average, there is one particular point per unit cube, because there are 8 corners of a cube, if we assume this particular room to be a cube, and each is being shared by 8 cubes. So on the average, there is always one point per unit cube. Okay. So whatever are the number of, what is the whatever is the volume, okay, if we divide by L cube upon 2 pi by 2 pi cube, that will be the total number of points which are expected to fall on this. So this is what I have said, 4 pi k square dk is the volume of this particular shell, and on the average, you expect one point in the volume 2 pi by L cube. Therefore, total number of points that are expected to fall is this particular factor, L cube, this particular thing, this thing, this particular factor, we multiply it by 2, because each of the state in principle can be occupied by 2 electrons, one by spin up and another by spin down. So spin generation is taken into consideration, so you multiply it by T. The relationship between E and energy and momentum is very simple, E is equal to h square k square by 2m. So you convert this particular thing from k space to energy space, you just change the variable, this is what you will get. And this is a well-known density of state function, this is generally called density of state, which goes as e to the power half. Free electron density of state goes as e to the power half, very well known. Now, if I have to calculate how many number of points are lying between energy E and E plus D, see, these are the number of states, these are the total number of chairs in the room, okay? If they are occupied or they are not occupied, depends on statistics. So if I have to find out what is the probability or what are the numbers of electrons which are likely to lie between energy E and E plus DE, I must multiply by the Fermi-Dirac function. So let's be very clear, GED is the total number of states available, total number of chairs available, okay? How many of them are occupied? This is given by NEDE. And this NEDE has to be obtained by multiplying this by the Fermi-Dirac function, because Fermi-Dirac tells you what is the probability of occupancy of this particular state, which is, as all of you know, Fermi-Dirac statistics is given by 1 upon e to the power e minus ef by kt plus 1. This is the Fermi-Dirac function. Of course, there is unknown which is called Fermi energy, which has to be evaluated by knowing the total number of particles. That's what we are going to discuss just now. All right. So this is the total number of occupancy. Now, this particular thing is rather easy to evaluate at t is equal to 0, because at t is equal to 0, what you will find that if I put in this particular expression t is equal to 0, denominator is 0, and if E is less than EF, then this becomes infinity minus infinity. If it becomes minus infinity, this particular factor becomes 0, so overall factor becomes 1. If E is greater than EF, then this becomes plus infinity, therefore this 1 can be neglected, this 1 upon infinity becomes 0. Which makes sense, because at 0 degree Kelvin, you expect states up till a particular energy to be completely occupied, because you're not giving them any additional energy to the system. And after you have accommodated all your electrons, okay, after that all the states are going to be empty. So remember, all people would have liked, the particle would have liked to go to the lowest available energy state. If the energy state is not available at 0 degree Kelvin, that particle is forced to go to higher energy state. But it will never happen at 0 degree Kelvin that it will leave a vacant state at a lower energy and go to higher energy state. When you give them additional energy in the form of temperature, then it's possible. But otherwise, at 0 degree Kelvin, it's not possible. It will always take the lowest unoccupied state. Okay? So if I do that particular thing, I can calculate at t is equal to 0 and calculate what is the EF, what is Fermi energy. Yes.
We can tell whether may or may not the electron will lie at the level EF in that case.
See, that's precisely what I'm trying to say. If at all you have a particular state which is exactly at that particular energy E is equal to EF, okay, it depends on how many number of electrons you have been able to occupy. Okay, you have to accommodate about 23 electrons. Now, that particular state at E is equal to EF may, let's have a degeneracy, I'm just giving some number, arbitrary number, let's say 100. Okay, at the most it can occupy 200 electrons. Now, it depends when your electrons get exhausted. If you have only 5 electrons left, you know, out of 200, there will be only 5 electron states. Okay, other will be empty. But you know, you're talking of electrons of 4 or 5 electrons out of 10 to the power 23. Okay, I mean, this is, again, as we say, taking skin out of the, you know, hair. So we never talk about it. So we know that below EF, all are occupied. Above that, all have to be unoccupied.
All are filled.
What happens at EF? We don't bother about it.
In the formula also, if you put E equal to EF, then 0 by 0, indeterminate will come.
See, that's why I'm saying it's a discontinuity. Okay, so if you take the Fermi energy at, this is what you calculate. If you have total number of n electrons, okay, so I calculate GED, because the Fermi factor is either 1 or 0. So normally I should have integrated up to finite energy, but we know this particular factor will be 1 for all energies up to Fermi energy and will be 0 for energies later. So this integral reduces to 0 to EF into GE. So this NE factor is either 1 or 0. We put the expression there of GED, which we have evaluated, then solve it, you get this is the expression of Fermi energy. It means h square you know, 2m you know, you are supposed to know total number of atoms per unit volume, total number of electrons per unit volume, okay, which, for example, at least for alkali metals, that there is one electron per atom. So know total number of atoms per unit volume, okay, from that you can calculate what will be the Fermi energy. So this is just for typically for sodium. For sodium, the density turns out to be 0.971 gram per cc, atomic weight is 22.9, so you can calculate N by V. So this is the factor. Put in the expression, you get for Fermi, the Fermi energy to be 3.16 electron volts. This number is a very, very interesting number because it tells you that even at 0 degree Kelvin, the electrons have energy of 3.16 electron volt. In Root model, okay, at room temperature, the electron energy was of the, in fact, you can calculate the average energy, it turned out to be 3 by 5, but let's not bother about it. See, at the time in the Root's model, an electron at room temperature will have an energy of 3 by 2 kT. And as I have just now said, kT is 1 upon 40 electron volt. So the value of energy of an electron at room temperature will be equal to 3 by 2 divided by 40, okay, which is typically of the order 0.04 electron volt at room temperature. While in the case of Sommerfeld model, even at 0 degree Kelvin, you have electrons which have energies which are two orders higher in magnitude. So electrons are having such large, and remember there is no potential energy here, they are free. So all this energy is kinetic energy. So even at 0 degree Kelvin, you find that electrons are moving with very, very large velocities, even at 0 degree Kelvin. So this is a big contrast from Root's model. Now you can also calculate Fermi energy at finite temperature. This is the expression normally we do in MSc class, we actually evaluate this particular expression. That Fermi energy is also actually shows a small temperature dependence, but this temperature dependence is fairly small. Because at room temperature, the kT is 1 upon 40 electron volt and EF0 is typically 3 to 4 electron volt, and there is a square term here. So this particular term will be of the order of 10^-4. So to a good approximation, we can assume for metals, remember for metals, that Fermi energy is temperature independent. Okay? Though it has a very small dependence, very, very small dependence, but it can always be ignored. So if we assume that whatever is the value of Fermi energy that we have obtained at room temperature, for all practical purposes, okay, I can use the same value of Fermi energy. Now Fermi energy is also expressed into various units, Fermi velocity, Fermi wave vector, Fermi temperature, let's not go into the details. This is the table which gives the Fermi energy in electron volts for most of the metals. So alkali metals, these are the values. If you go to noble metals like copper, it's 7 electron volts, silver is 5.51 electron volts. Now these are some of the observations. Fermi energy is around 2 orders of magnitude higher than the value of kT at room temperature. Even though the energy of the system at T is equal to 0 is much higher than the average energy of the classical gas at room temperature, its increase with T is very, very small. Now let's understand this particular factor. Let's go back to our Fermi function. This was my Fermi function. Here you have E minus EF by kT. In fact, what I normally do, ask students that why don't you calculate this particular expression for different values of E minus EF by kT. Remember, there is an exponential factor here. Okay, you realize that if E minus EF is, let's say, plus 10 kT, it means Fermi energy was approximately 3 to 4 electron volt. Okay, 10 kT will be 0.25 electron volt. Then this factor will be e raised power 10. E raised power 10 is a huge number. Okay, one can be neglected, probability will be essentially 0. All right, if I put E minus EF is equal to minus 10 kT, okay, probability will be essentially 1, because this factor will be essentially minus infinity, almost like that. In principle, because of this exponential factor, you will find that E minus EF by kT will be different from 0 or 1 only around approximately kT of Fermi energy. Because that's where, I mean, you can just do a small calculator and calculate the values. This is what we give as a problem to the student. Just calculate this number. You will find that this will be more close to 1 or 0. Only time when it will be different from 0 to 1 is only around kT of this particular Fermi energy, which also makes sense physically, because most of the electrons are so deep rooted that by giving them such a small energy, tiny energy, 0.025, only those electrons which are very, very close to Fermi energy, they may be able to get those energies. But an electron which is now deep rooted inside and you are giving them 0.025, and you expect that this particular electron will jump to a state which is available only after 3 electron volt above, chances are very, very low. So essentially, only the electrons which are very close to the Fermi energy, they are the ones which are going to get occupied. They are going to leave their states and going to occupy higher energy states. So most of the excitation takes place only close to the Fermi energy. Only the electrons which are close to the Fermi energy are the ones which get affected. Why? By heat, they go and occupy higher energy states. Okay? Most of the electrons which are deep-rooted, they are not affected by temperature at all. So what is happening? That when I am at T is equal to 0, they have a lot of energy. But when I heat, the heat is never absorbed by the system. Because only few electrons which are close to the Fermi energy, they are the one which can actually go to higher energy states. Therefore, we can understand why free electron contribution to specific heat is small. Because specific heat depends on rate of increase of energy, dE dt. It does not depend on E. It depends on dE dt. E is very large, but dE dt is very small. Therefore, free electrons do not contribute drastically to the specific heat of the system. So this is what I have written here. Even though the energy of the system at T is equal to 0 is much higher than the average energy of the classical gas at room temperature, its increase with T is quite small. The free electron contribution to specific heat is therefore quite small. It can be shown, in fact, again, if you do calculation, it can be shown that the free electron contribution to specific heat is proportional to temperature and hence can be seen at very low temperatures. In fact, this, a lot of people do this experiments. If you go to very low temperature, in fact, you can put the numbers only below 10 Kelvin, you will start finding that free electron contribution can be seen separately. See, if you are knowing about the Debye's law, the lattice contribution goes as T cube. That's called Debye's T cube law, very, very well known. The specific heat at low temperature because of the vibration goes as T cube, while free electron contribution goes as T, is proportional to T. So if you are going to very low temperature, it's the T contribution which will start dominating. And that will happen typically around 4 to 5 degree Kelvin. So if you are able to make measurements below that temperature, you go to very, very low temperature and make the measurements. Of course, these days it's possible to do those measurements. Then you will find a clear-cut free electron contribution. So free electrons do contribute, but they contribute very, very small. And at room temperature, the contribution is absolutely small. Now, only electrons close to Fermi energy take part. So there is one particular part which we have been able to explain, but we go off into another part. Because conduction also will be taken care by only a very small number of electrons which are close to the Fermi energy. So when I calculate the mean free path, I cannot use RMS speed that I had calculated, but I must use Fermi speed. Okay? So in Sommerfeld model, the mean free path is actually calculated by Fermi energy multiplied by tau. Tau we had already calculated by using our old free electron model. Okay? If you do that particular thing, and because Fermi velocity is much larger, okay, then you will find that mean free paths have become very large. So typically in Sommerfeld model, the mean free path will turn out to be of the order of 200 to 300 angstrom, 20 to 30 nanometers. Okay? Now, this contradicts from our earlier happiness when we said that this mean free path actually came out to be equal to almost interatomic distances. Now, it's very difficult to believe that if you have atom every 1 nanometer, okay, the electron is able to travel 20 to 30 nanometers without suffering any collision. Very, very difficult to assume. So, though we could understand on the basis of Sommerfeld model why free electron contribution should be small to this specific heat, but as far as mean free path is concerned, we became off. There is one more experiment which I would like to mention, which is Hall effect experiment. It's a very, very interesting experiment. It's still even performed today for many of the model materials. Let's just discuss Hall effect and its role as far as the free electron theory is concerned. This was performed for the first time in 1879 by Hall, much, much older time, much before the discovery of electron. It's a very important research tool. In fact, if some of you have been working in the area of magnetism, which happens to be my area of research, okay, one of the most common way of measuring magnetic field is using Hall probe. Okay, you put a small probe there, it measures Hall effect, and from that you actually calculate what is the magnetic field. I mean, that's not the most accurate method of calculating field, but most of the common method to find out the magnetic field between any magnet. Okay. As far as this particular experiment is concerned, why I am describing it here is that this particular Hall effect can be used to determine the sign of charge carriers. See, remember, at the time of Hall, we did not know that they are electrons. Okay. It can only tell you which were the sign charge. People knew that there is a positive charge, people knew that there is a negative charge. Charges are of two type, it was known. Okay. Concept of electron was not known. All right. So this particular experiment can be designed or is designed to show what is the sign of charge carrier, whether it's positive charge carriers which carry the current or whether it's the negative charge carriers which carry the current. So let us first describe this particular Hall effect experiment. Here we use all the three dimensions. Let's take sample in the form of a block, a rectangular block, and we use all the three dimensions. We allow, I mean, these XYZ directions are also fixed, you know, the way we talk about them, okay. So conventionally, we always say that current flows, the conventional current flows along the positive X direction. So there is X direction, and that's the direction in which the conventional current flows, all right. Then in the positive Z direction, we apply a magnetic field, all right. Now, if you have X direction, you have a Z direction, plus Y direction is fixed because you have to have a right-handed system. So, you know what is plus Y direction. Now, question is, what will happen in the y direction? So, let us try to understand it. See, there is a current flowing. Now, there is a magnetic field applied. So, current is because of the motion of charge carriers. Because of Lorentz force, these charge carriers will experience a force. And you can very easily show that this force will be along the y direction, plus y or minus y. All right? Because of that, there will be accumulation of charges on the y phase, and electric field will be generated in the y direction until this field exactly cancels out the Lorentz field. And at that time, a steady state will reach. So, an outcome will be that along the y direction, you will find a voltage developed, which is generally called as Hall voltage. Okay, let's understand this particular thing a little more. So let's first assume that charge carriers are positive, just for the sake of it, sake of the arguments. So if the charge carriers are positive, it means they must all be flowing in the direction of the conventional current. Because the conventional current is plus x direction, therefore, these charge carriers must be drifting along the plus x direction. Okay, therefore, this V, which is there in the Lorentz force, I am writing as Vx times I. Because this is along the I direction.
Question.
Yeah.
Is it okay to write F is equal to Q times V cross B as Lorentz force? Because we have the other term.
No, see, in this case of that electric field, yep. E times E, that I am sort of ignoring in this particular case. Of course, you know, you have that part.
Sorry.
See, let me put it like that. No, you are right. You know, you are 100% right. Because actually, we should write E times E plus V cross B. That's what is the term. This electric field has been used to cause this particular current. Okay, so I am only looking at that particular force which is along the y direction. You are 100% right. If I do a more detailed analysis, I must use that particular current also. Okay, but that does not matter. The result, outcome result turns out to be exactly identical. I have applied a field in the x direction. Because of that, I am getting current in the x direction. Okay, now if I am getting the current in the x direction, because of that, there is a V. Otherwise, drift velocity would have been zero.
Yeah, actually, if you write E plus that thing,
yeah,
then it will automatically come.
See, I agree.
EY will be equal to that thing. I mean, that force will be equal to...
You are 100% right. In fact, many times we do in that particular fashion also. We also take the electric field separately. We write EE and then try about X direction. Okay. Then we are talking only in terms of electric field. Okay. Here, what I have done, the electric field effect I have taken already in the form of current, because that is anyway not going to give me a force along the Y direction. So, I am looking only along the Y direction. Other than the Hall voltage, there is a Hall field also. Eventually, in equilibrium state, there will be two electrical fields. One will be along the x direction, which has been responsible for me giving me the current. Another will be in the y direction, okay, which cancels this Lorentz force.
So that is my point. If you keep y there,
yeah,
and e there, then ey will be equal to the Hall field.
Precisely.
That will come automatically.
I fully agree with you. I mean, that's another way of doing it. I'm doing it a slightly different way. I'm not denying that you're incorrect. I'm saying that that's a probably more general way of doing it. Okay. So my B is, let's say, BZ times K. And I cross K will be minus J. So, we will feel that this particular forces, the force on these particular charge carriers is in the minus Y direction. Therefore, you will find that all the positive charges will accumulate at the bottom surface because this is Z direction, this has to be Y direction. So, you will find that because of this, the electric field will generate in the plus Y direction. Alright, so if you apply, take a voltmeter, you will find the direction of the voltage. Now, if we assume negative charge carriers, then this Q becomes minus Q. And if there is a current in the plus X direction, then these charge must be moving in the minus X direction. Okay? Therefore, this V also becomes minus I, and there is a minus sign because of the charge carriers being negative. You find that the force direction is still minus EY. And therefore, in this case, what will happen? That the negative charges will get accumulated at the bottom face. And therefore, the field will be generated in the minus y direction. So, knowing the direction of the field along the y direction, you will be able to find it out how much, whether the charge carriers are positive or negative. But in addition to this, we can also get one more information from the Hall effect. That's what is quite interesting. In equilibrium, I expect that a field will be generated along the y direction, which will be in this particular direction. You must have net field equal to zero, as he has mentioned. We define a quantity which is called Hall coefficient. Hall coefficient is defined in terms of all the experimentally measured quantities. If you have allowed a current to flow in the x direction, you know what will be the current density. If you applied a magnetic field, you know what is the magnetic field value. Then eventually you will calculate what will be the voltage along the y direction. So you will find out what will be EY. So you take EY divided by GX by BZ, this is what is called Hall coefficient. Okay, this can be positive or negative. It will be positive if the charge carriers are positive, it will be negative if the charge carriers are negative. If we substitute all those numbers, which I have done it earlier, the magnitude of the Hall coefficient turns out to be equal to 1 upon n cube, where n is the total number of charge carriers per unit volume, as we have discussed earlier. This comes because the current density is given by nq times vx. Just put these values here, you get 1 upon nq. Okay? So Hall effect can be used for two purposes. It not only gives you the sign of charge carriers, it also gives you their number, the total number of charge carriers per unit volume. So this particular experiment can be used to test free electron theory. You can find out whether this n that you have evaluated matches with our idea that there is one electron per, let's say, alkali metal which becomes free. Now this is a table which I have taken again from a textbook, which I will give you the reference. This table gives you the value of 1 upon RH divided by NE. This RH is experimentally measured quantity, and N has been calculated just by assuming total number of atoms per unit volume. All right. Now, if everything, whatever I have said, is correct, then for all alkali metals, I must get this particular expression to be equal to 1, because sodium is monovalent. So you expect that this should be equal to 1. But when you actually do this measurement and evaluate N the way I have just now said, you get for sodium the value 1.2. For potassium, it's 1.1. Rubidium, it matches pretty well. For cesium, it's 0.9. These are all alkali metals. If you go to noble metals, we become slightly more off, 1.3, 1.5. Alkali metals, you can probably, I mean, say that's okay, 10%, 20%, you know, after all, we have assumed electrons to be free, which they are not. Okay? So we have made so many approximations which anybody can say that these are not correct approximations. So if you are getting agreement within 10%, you are happy. So you would say that things seem to be matching pretty well as far as sodium, potassium or all alkali metals are concerned. Reasonably okay, not very well though for noble metals. Silver, gold, copper seems to be matching okay. I can tolerate it, but not very happy. The biggest problem comes when we talk of metal which are in the second group of the periodic table, okay, or third column, because that's where you would expect that you may have 2 electrons per atom or 3 electrons per atom. For example, if you talk of aluminium, okay, it should have 3 electrons per atom. Let's look at the table. If you take beryllium, for which the valence is 2, or magnesium, for which the valence is 2, you actually get Hall coefficient to be positive. You don't even get negative. It appears that in these metals, as if the charge carriers are positive. And the number that we get has no bearing with the valency, 0.2, 0.4. Indium and aluminium, there also Hall coefficient is positive. Okay? While these are having 3 valency, while what if everything of free electron theory would have been correct, then I should have got here plus 3 or close to plus 3. Okay, here close to plus 2, close to plus 2. It clearly shows that free electron theory probably matches reasonably all right with alkali metals to somewhat tolerable limit for noble metals, but definitely not for group 2, group 3 metals. This table, the source is that famous book by Ashcroft and Berman, Solid State Physics. From that, there I have taken this particular table. So clearly, free electron theory does not work completely. Definitely not for group 2 and group 3 metals. This is the failures of free electron theory. Can still not explain the variation of resistivity with impurities, crystalline purity and temperature. This problem existed even in the Roots model case. Cannot explain positive Hall coefficient and number of charge carriers in some metals. Obviously, things are not all right for free electron theory. We must go to a little more important theory, a different theory. So another 10 minutes, I will talk about that particular theory and then we'll close this particular chapter. Next step is to assume that electron is not really free, but it is actually in a periodic potential. We'll be talking about the crystalline solids in the next lecture. See, in a regular crystal, we arrange the atoms to be arranged in a periodic way. So each of these positive charges, once these electrons have left them, should be positive charges, and there has to be a periodicity maintained in them. Because whatever happens close to this particular atom, exactly same thing should happen close to this particular atom, because this atom and this atom is perfectly, placed in exactly identical fashion. That's what's the starting point of a lattice, as we call it, that each atom or each point of the lattice must be having identical environment. So the next thing is to talk about, to discard the assumptions that electrons in the solids are free. Next step is to consider that electron experiences a periodic potential inside a solid. Let us consider one dimensional case for simplicity. So let's assume that my potential energy is not zero, but it obeys this particular condition that V of x plus Na must be equal to Vx, where A is what we call as a lattice constant. So at each distance of A, things are exactly identical. So if you have one atom here, another atom, the distance between them is A. So whatever you expect as the potential here must be at same here. Whatever is the potential here must be same here, because this atom are perfectly identically placed. So to solve this particular equation, you have a potential energy function which you assume to be of the form Vx plus Na is equal to Vx. I will just give the outcome of what happens. I will not go into the details of this particular thing. In fact, Bloch for the first time tried to solve this particular problem. For mathematics, there was some independent, I think Floquet was the person who solved similar type of differential equation in the mathematics. But in physics, it's generally called as a Bloch's theorem. And he found that the wave function of this particular electron in such a type of potential will be given in the form of phi x into ux of e raised power ikx. Remember, for free electron, it was just e raised power ikx. Now, all that has happened, that instead of constant times e raised power ikx, it becomes u of x into e raised power ikx. It becomes a function of x. And not any other function of x, but this particular function must also obey the periodicity of the lattice. So it must be ux plus Na is equal to ux. Now, actual shape of u would depend on what is the actual shape of v. We have not talked what is the shape of V. All that I have assumed is a periodicity condition. Okay, from that I have said that U will also be periodic. What will be the actual function of U of X will depend on what is V of X. Let me come to this particular thing and then probably I'll stop. I'll summarize this particular thing in one or two statements just to tell what happened in earlier transparency, but let me come to this particular thing. See, it can be shown that in the case of Bloch electron, the speed of the electron will be given by 1 upon h cross ded, energy as a function of wave vector. Actually, what I have just run through the earlier transparency, which I have not displayed, one can show that the wave vector of this particular electron, or what we call as a Bloch electron, does not have a unique value. And in the case of free electron, h cross k actually represents the momentum of the particle. Here, h cross k will not represent the momentum, because momentum has to have a unique value. So it's generally called crystal momentum. But what is the most important aspect which I want to emphasize, and where I would like to end this particular thing, is that this particular group velocity would be present even in the presence of completely periodic potential. That's the most important conclusion of Bloch's theorem, which essentially tells that if potential is perfectly periodic, the group velocity would not change. It means electron will not get scattered. Just mere presence of the potential would not cause electron to scatter. Electron scattering takes place when there is a departure from periodicity. That's why we always found out that when we add impurity, the resistivity went up. Because if, for example, instead of silver, I put a gold atom there, the charges in the nucleus of the gold atom is different. So the potential which you'll experience, the electron will experience when it comes close to the gold atom, will not be periodic. It's a departure from periodicity. Therefore, this will cause scattering. Okay? If there is a defect in the crystal, if the material has become amorphous, there is no periodicity. Therefore, electrons will get scattered. If there is a surface, it will cause scattering. When we heat the material, the electrons are no longer there, the ions or atoms are no longer at their regular position. They start vibrating. This is a departure from periodicity. All these will cause actually the scattering of the electrons. And that's why you will find that resistivity depends on these factors, which we had always found out, but never able to understand. So essentially, it's the change from periodicity that caused the scattering of the electron, and not just mere presence of periodic potential. A perfectly periodic potential will not scatter electrons. I think I'll stop here. Yeah.
Vibration of the lattice. Is it like that harmonic phonons are not scattering, or kind of thing?
Any phonon, whether harmonic or non-harmonic, does not matter. If there is a presence of phonon, there is always electron phonon scattering.
Yeah.
Okay, so where you can still assume phonons to be because of harmonic interaction. See, anharmonicity comes because of some other reasons. When there are two lattice waves and when they have to mix up, okay, that is caused by anharmonicity. But as far as electron phonon scattering is concerned, I don't think anharmonicity is needed. Okay, when two lattice waves, you know, sort of get scattered with each other, when we talk of thermal conductivity, we have to talk about anharmonicity. But when we talk of electrical conductivity, as far as I know, I don't think anharmonicity is needed. See, crystal momentum is just h cross k. See, let me just tell this particular transparencies. See, what you can show that any value of k, if you add what we call as a reciprocal lattice vector, about which we'll talk later, okay, can equally well represent the wave vector. So k, that, see, remember, what is k here? This is the k. Okay. Now this k, this whole wave function can be rewritten in a different fashion, that instead of k here, there is another k appearing. And instead of that ux, there is another ux, which also has the same periodicity. It means the k that you are assigning, the wave vector that you are assigning to the electron, is not a unique value. It can have different values. Therefore, k is not related to its momentum. All right? So we call h cross k as crystal momentum of the particle. But what happens when we talk of the semi-classical equation of motion which we talk? Essentially, this crystal momentum almost acts as momentum. All right? So generally, I mean, in solid state physics, whenever you talk about momentum, people always mean crystal momentum. Always. See, what is a band structure? If you say, what is the band structure of silicon or band structure of germanium? Okay, band structure means relationship between E and K, what we call as a dispersion relation. Okay, when we say relationship between E and K, it's always relationship between energy and crystal momentum. In solid state physics, we only talk about crystal momentums, which are basically the wave vectors. Any other question?
They are talking about the degenerate and non-degenerate semiconductors, oxide semiconductors.
Yeah.
In that case, the density of states high and low.
No. Well, when we talk of the degenerate semiconductors, if I remember right, we talk of highly doped semiconductors. See, what happens when you talk of Fermi energy in the case of semiconductors, things have to be looked slightly differently. Because let's say I talk of T is equal to 0. T is equal to 0, all the states in the valence band are filled, and all the states in conduction band are empty. So in principle, your Fermi energy can be anywhere in the band gap. Only thing, it has to be in the band gap. All right? Because above this, all the states are empty at T is equal to 0. Below that, every state are occupied. Now, in order to calculate Fermi energy in the case of semiconductors, you use a different boundary condition altogether. You take the charge neutrality condition, and then you determine Fermi energy. Now, what happens when you heavily doped it, you find that this particular Fermi energy, for example, if it is N-type of doping, the Fermi energy comes closer to the conduction band. If it is P-type, it comes closer to the valence band. If you dope it very, very heavily, then it's possible that it goes into one of the bands. Okay, that's what is called generally degenerate, if I remember right. Okay, thank you.